the 6-7 Figure Show, episode 84. Ready? Let's hit it.
Broadcasting from the Valley of the Sun outside Phoenix, Arizona, this is the 6-7 Figure Show. Tired of working so hard and having no time? Take your six-figure practice and turn it to a thriving seven-figure enterprise. And now, your host, author, speaker, mentor, and strategist, Frank Bria.
Hey everyone, welcome to the 6-7 Figure Show. I'm your host, Frank Bria, and in today's episode, we are going to talk about serial entrepreneurism. But first, a quick message from our sponsor. This episode of the 6-7 Figure Show is brought to you by High Ticket Program. Did you know you're only 12 projects away from turning your six-figure practice into a seven-figure enterprise? In the High Ticket Program Accelerator, we guide you through every step of growth and scale, a process we call LEAP. Imagine having a world-class project team guiding you and your team through each and every step of pain-free growth, all with the goal of becoming a seven-figure enterprise and moving away from painful, time-consuming business operations and client delivery. Get a taste of LEAP in your own business by downloading our free high-ticket program core offer black book that contains more than 60 pages of standard operating procedures for your business, including onboarding, customer service, graduation, financial management, and a lot more. You can get that for free by going to the show's homepage, 6-7.show. That's 6-7.show for your free black book. I am absolutely pleased to introduce today's guest, Cody Getchell. He is a true serial entrepreneur. Then after putting himself through university and buying and selling used cars, he started a digital marketing agency that he has since grown to over seven figures in annual revenue, and he now runs a real estate Facebook group that is over 2,000 strong. Cody, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much, Frank.
Hey, so we had talked a little bit before the interview, so I want to jump into this first off. What is it that makes a serial entrepreneur successful at this? Like, there are people who, you know, maybe start and fail businesses and they may call themselves a serial entrepreneur, but, you know, what do you think is the driving force that gets somebody to kind of go through the craziness of starting a business more than once?
Honestly, I think it's ambition and persistence, right? Like, it's a cliche that people say that, you know, you got to take every failure as a lesson, but as an entrepreneur and as a person that's going to run a business and do that kind of stuff, you really have to take that to heart. It really has to be something that you really understand and push forward with, because every successful person in business, most every successful person in business has a whole pile of failures that they're standing on in order to reach that success, right? So, and the persistence to get through that, but also the ambition, and you have to enjoy it, right? I've always said to everybody that asks me, you know, people have hobbies, and to me, hobbies have been starting businesses and trying to see what works and doing this and doing that since I was like, I don't know, 14 years old, selling candy bars on the playground kind of thing, right? So like, it's something that people say, you know, I like, I think it's Gary Vee that brings it up all the time, that he applies the metaphor of an athlete, right? You have to have the drive and the practice and that desire to work all the time and to push through all the crap and do all that and get to the next point. And I'm a true believer of that.
Yeah. And it's interesting you say, when you talk about it sort of being endemic, you know, even at a young age. I mean, I know it sounds really strange, but when I was 10 years old, my birthday present was office supplies. I had like one of those closets in my bedroom that had a shelf like at about, you know, belly size there. And so you could put a chair in there, and yeah, I had a stapler and a stuff. So
no, that's perfect. Like I said, like, I don't know what middle school, what age that would be, 9, 10, somewhere around that age. Yeah, I would actually, this is my first taste into entrepreneurship. I would go to, there was this canteen that would close right before the bus. I'd buy out all the candy bars, and then I'd go to the outside, I'd sell them for twice as much.
Yeah, exactly.
First business I ever ran right there.
Everyone's got some story like that. Yeah, I think my first business was, there was this craze in school at the time for these little like pom-pom animals. And, you know, people were just like little googly eyes on pom-poms and heads and tails and stuff. And yeah, me and a friend of mine started doing that, and I got my first cash box. that started like keeping the cash in there. I was probably 11, I think.
But it's fun, right? That's how you know it's in your blood, because you're enjoying it. Like when you're that, you're doing it purely for the fun of it. And it's just something that instills that going forward. Right? I think that's really important.
Well, and because you brought up, like, there are, I mean, I don't think anyone can get through an entrepreneurial experience without having a series of setbacks, you know, call them failures, whatever you want to call them. And you talk about the ambition and the drive, but there's also this this other sort of element that gets people through those setbacks. But talk about that. I mean, there have been experiences as you've been going through this process where it was just really hard to push through and to get through, and what the lesson was out of that?
100%. Yeah, I've had a couple times, especially early on. I mean, I've been running this agency now for 7-8 years, and we've got a big roster, and we've crossed, you know, a number of thresholds that we wanted to hit. But it's been, you know, it's like this, you know. And I like to say every business is a roller coaster, and you look at it like a graph. And if you zoom real close in, it looks like the most, you know, heart attack inducing crap ever. One really good month, one really bad month, and you're just like this. So a few good months, and then this. But if you zoom out, what you have to have is, you know, it's tilted. So it's going like this, but it's going like this in an upward direction. And if you can start to understand that and learn, one of the hardest lessons I learned was patience, right?
Yeah.
So I went to university. I have a BBA in business administration, honors in marketing, honors in accounting, and all this stuff. And then I was buying and selling used cars to go through university. And then I decided to move that stuff over into marketing. And you know, you're when you're younger and you're just coming out, you're like, I know everything, and this is going to work great. And it's not always like that. And so a hard lesson is to be patient. You want everything to work right away, but a lot of, especially with marketing and with building a brand and this kind of stuff, takes time. It's not going to be like a switch you flip on and everything's golden. It's a thing you grow over time. So zoom in, it looks like a disaster. Zoom out, you've had steady growth, and that's what you want.
Well, it's funny when you say a zoom in is like a heart attack. I think it really, really does look like an EKG, you know, pulse. But yeah, the steady growth is what you're shooting for. I couldn't agree more about the patience piece, and I am not an incredibly patient person. In fact, that's probably the first really tough gut-punching piece of feedback I got when I was doing tech startups, and you know, they had the venture capitalists who really have long, you know, long horizons for payoffs. You know, said to me that that was their feedback on me, is you're not patient enough for this. If you don't figure this patience thing out, you are not going to make it. Because I thought I was, you know, hot stuff and knew what I was doing at the time. And so that was really a tough piece of feedback for me, to sit back and think that, you know, this was a personality flaw or a personality dynamic I was going to have to master. Mm-hmm. But it's not just a patience with the time. I do think it's also a patience with yourself as you're going through this, because any entrepreneur who starts this process, we don't know all the answers to all the stuff. And in fact, I think a lot of times we convince us there are answers when we're really there aren't. You know, there's just a plan and an execution of the plan. And, you know, it's not so much, you know, which plan is going to be the right plan, but sort of sticking with a plan when you've got one.
Yeah. And I mean, on that point specifically, I always tell people who ask me what are the most important things to learn before they start a business: sales. Because sales be all end all. You can't sell it. There's no reason you're going to get into it in the first place.
Right.
And learn to be a problem solver. You can know everything else you want to know, but if you can't put out fires and deal with the mental strain of constantly having to put out fires, then it's probably not going to be.
Well, yeah, that's such a good point, because I think one thing that entrepreneurs who haven't grown their business beyond themselves, mm-hmm. they feel like all they're doing is solving problems, and it's like one crisis to the next. And what they don't understand is that being a CEO is always solving problems. Like, that's your job.
Yeah,
it's just the problems change and the scope of the problems change. But, you know, even when I was working with the CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, all they did was solve problems. That was their job, you know? Yeah.
So that's 100% the executive's job. You think that you're going to remove yourself from the fulfillment part of it, and you're going to delegate it all out, and then everything's going to be great. I'm going to go lay on a beach. The company's going to run itself. No, that's a lie that people in Facebook ads tell you. That's not how it works. The more people you have under you, there's just more problems that you're going to have.
You may be on a beach. You're just solving problems from a beach. Yeah. You know, you're solving problems with a Mai Tai in your hand, but you're still solving problems. There's no peaceful path for an entrepreneur. So how did you start up a digital marketing agency? What was that process like?
So honestly, when I first started, what it was, I was ending university. I didn't really want to flip cars anymore, buying them from the auctions, all that kind of stuff. It wasn't really what I wanted to do, right? So like I said, I had a marketing degree, like a BBA, a 4-year degree in marketing. So I wanted to kind of put that to use. At first I was like, maybe I'll be an accountant. Like I said, I got honors in both. I had both set up, but I sat at a desk for 5 seconds, decided I didn't want to do that. I didn't want to, the corporate gig wasn't for me to sit there and listen to other people tell me how to do it and how to grow. So marketing seemed like the right way to go, because I had been selling some of the cars using the digital world and flipping and that kind of stuff. Back then, about 8 years ago, it was a different landscape, right? So it wasn't really so much now, it is convincing people that we are better than all the other million digital marketers that are out there. Back then, it was actually convincing people that they even should be on Google or Facebook or whatever else, right? So completely different game. Now it's a little easier, right? They know they need to be on Facebook. They just don't know how to do it. So it's a little bit of an easier game. So when I first started, that was it. A real estate agent was my very first client. We just started with some branding and I started getting my feet wet in Facebook ads and kind of went from there.
Great. And your digital agency is an agency. And so you're doing work for folks. I know people who, you know, when they contemplate the agency business model or they talk to other folks about starting an agency, one of the fears they have is it is growing that model. What are some of the things that you've put in place that have allowed you to grow an agency business model so that you're not sort of stuck in, you know, we don't have any time to take on another client kind of a thing?
So I'll take this question in two different parts, because I think this is a really important part. The first one for agency owners or freelancers who think they're agency owners, it's when you decide to transition and hire people is very, very important, right? So a lot of people I don't know where this myth came out, but some people think every 5 clients or every X amount of clients, they need to hire a new person.
Yeah.
And they don't properly, I don't know if it's just that they don't have the business training, they don't have the accounting training, but they don't look at their books. Like they don't look and say, okay, I'm making this much money. I have this much money. I have this much time, and say, okay, I can afford to hire a person. They're taught by a guru or they're taught by a person, something that, hey, you hit this mark, hire somebody else. And I've seen it time and time again. And often it plays out quite publicly where they grow. And then they just hire like a whole team. And then that puts so much strain on their resources, on them mentally, because now you're not just trying to supply for your own life. You have to supply enough revenue for all of these team members and all that stuff. So
and keep it going. Yeah. Sustain it.
Yeah. And I mean, especially in new agencies, they run into the revolving door of clients too. So they get a big client, they have the 80-20 rule, and they get that 80. You know, they get that 80% of revenue from that one client. And then they think they're golden because, you know, when you first get a client, you think you're going to have them forever, especially when you're a brand new freelancer or agency. And, you know, often that doesn't work out, especially when you're brand new and you don't have the methods in place to crush that. Sure. They leave. Now you can't afford the 5 people you brought on just because of that one cash flow and it all collapses. So number one piece of advice, don't hire until you have to. And number two is to develop out your SOPs before you hire in the first place.
Yeah.
So what I used to do was try and replicate myself. I failed a few times, again, with the failures. These are all piling up behind us, but I'm standing on them now. I failed at trying to hire myself. The first like 3 major hires I tried to do, it was like, okay, cool. Now here's a little me and do all the stuff that I do. But that meant like all of it, like, you know, help with the ads, help with the SEO, help with the team management, all this kind of stuff. And it always failed, right? So now the more successful method is we have a crap ton. I don't know if we're allowed to use French on this podcast, so I'm not going to use French. Of SOPs built out for every single process.
Yeah.
So even stuff that you would think that you went and trained for years and years to learn how to do, say like e-commerce, Facebook ads, and do it profitably and all the systems and all that stuff, you can dump that information if you've learned it right and use the Einstein principle, you know, explain it as simply as possible, or you don't actually know it at all. Yeah. And dump them into step-by-step processes, step-by-step SOPs, every single part of it. And then you build out team members who have simple tasks that they can repeat all day long. And you can do it that way. A lot of what we do, we have people here. So we have 2 offices. We have one in Vancouver, one down in LA. And we have employees in both of those. And then we also have a lot of stuff outsourced overseas for cheaper labor to the, you know, the Philippines, to India, those kind of places.
Sure.
And the only reason we can use places like that is because of our in-depth SOPs and the process.
Because you put those things in place. Yeah. I think, you know, what you're describing is harder than I think a lot of folks think it is. And it's not impossible. It's doable, but you really do have to think through those things very carefully. And it is very easy to look at the revenue line and say, you know, it's at this point that we're going to start bringing people in. When you're not looking at the bottom line, And I think you might be right. It's either the business training or the, you know, being able to look at the numbers and think about it from an accounting perspective. But this idea of growing and hiring and sort of keeping the revenue and the costs like aligned as you go up, that is probably one of the hardest things a CEO has to do. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people, you know, misgauge how difficult that can be. And growing an agency. So hats off to you for doing that and continuing to do that. But it is a very difficult thing. I think a lot of people think it's not as bad. The other thing that I want to say, you've given some great advice on, is the standard operating procedures, having that down before you start hiring people. I mean, I've made this mistake too, where I've brought people in going, we need help, thinking we'll do it sort of on the fly as they get there. And, you know, we don't, and then it fails. And you really have to have a very clear understanding of what people are going to do before they show up on day one.
You kind of like flesh that out as they work, but you need to have some like skeleton structure at least before they come. Something I like to have myself that I do even now still when I'm looking to think about delegating something out, I'll do a matrix on a sheet of paper, okay? And then the top corner will be things that I'm good at and things that I want to do, okay? And over here are things that I'm bad at and I don't want to do, and then so forth. Like over here's things I'm really good at but I don't want to do. Right. And then over here, things that I'm bad at, you know, but I can get it done. So that's the matrix. And then I'll fill that up with as much as I can remember of daily activities for the last like month. And then whatever falls in this bottom little corner, if I'm still doing stuff that I'm bad at and I don't want to do, delegate that off. If that box is empty, woohoo, go me, but I still need to delegate that off, and you move over here and so forth. Right. So it's a good, really good practice for a lot of people, especially if you're first hire, you're ready to go hire out this box. You're bad at it, so it's not helping your business.
Yeah.
You don't want to do it, so it's mentally draining and you're not having fun. So that's the first thing that you need to create SOPs for and delegate it off and get that.
Yep, absolutely. That great exercise, I think, for anyone who's listening, if you haven't gone through that exercise, for sure. You have you also have training for real estate folks. How did you pivot into that? Where did that come from?
So we've actually had the Real Estate Rainmakers. I'm not going to say a side business. It's a part of our company, but it's a niche product, basically, is what we're doing. So we've been doing lead gen for them for the entire 7-8 years that I've been running. Rahul, my business partner that's doing it, he's done it for about 14 years. He actually worked for Realtor.com, and they were a client of his and all that stuff as well. So we have a lot of different campaigns that just work and a lot of different angles that they can take. And one thing that I think that a lot of realtors are sick of is having to rely on Zillow, on Trulia, and that kind of stuff for their products. So we put together a training that on Facebook ads so they can do it themselves. And inside the training, we have all of our top campaigns. And we also show exactly how to create using like a persona worksheet and a ad copy template. They can plug and play any angle that they want and it will generate leads because we know that all of these things work and they can put that into play. So it's kind of just morphed over time. We do the lead gen and fulfillment ourselves, but we find it better to help them be able to do it for themselves. It's more fulfilling for them and it's more fulfilling for us because we know that that's a big pain point in the market right now.
Right. So this kind of is born out of some agency work you were doing before, and now it's just kind of blown up into a bigger thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a great way to branch out an additional income stream. That's terrific.
And it just happens to work out too that we now have a whole bunch of marketers, digital marketers who want to work with real estate agents that are going through the course now. And they're just absolutely ecstatic with it because now they can get better results for their clients and they can lean on our stuff and our campaigns. And they're absolutely crushing it now as well. So
great.
More people that we've ended up helping that, you know, we didn't even realize at the time that we were going
to be. Yeah, no, it's great. It's great that it worked out that way. So since you mentioned lead gen, I want to pivot into this a little bit. So your business, the agency business, digital marketing, has there been sort of an evolution of how you've acquired clients as you've gotten bigger? Has that changed, or are you kind of doing the same things you did early stages and they keep working for you just now at a bigger scale?
Well, I'm a big practice what you preach person. So as we've grown and as we've accumulated more resources, what we've done is we've just invested into more and more channels.
Okay.
If there's one thing your sales team is going to complain to you about, it's that they don't have enough people to talk to. Right? So the number one complaint you're ever going to hear from salespeople, yes. Of course, if I had them on the phone, I could close them. Of course, if there's people talking to me, we'd have all kinds of sales. So
yep.
In order to just completely avoid that altogether, we invest into
lead. Yeah.
Right. The number one thing that a healthy company needs is a healthy pipeline. So right. As we've grown, you know, we've always done PPC. We've always done some Facebook ads. We've done SEO for our own websites. We invest into, you know, listing ads, all that kind of stuff. YouTube is something we branched out into recently. So we're doing a lot of YouTube ads, a lot of this, a lot of that. And we also stay on top of the market. So things like we have large, complicated funnels involving webinars and all this stuff. And Facebook ads are shifting right now to potentially penalize webinars. So that we have to evolve and grow with that to maybe shorter VSLs, different kinds of stuff like that. So we omni-channel is what I would say we are at right now. And for a small agency just starting out, really, I think you should look into places that aren't as overly saturated as other places. So honestly, look into different things that what everybody else is doing. So we invest pretty heavily into things like LinkedIn automation, Google PPC ads, and Facebook ads. But if you don't have a huge budget, you might not be able to play in that auction right now.
Yes.
Right. If you don't have that, then I would suggest potentially looking into, you know, different areas. YouTube right now, if you do it right, is not as heavily competitive as some of the other areas. So that might be a good place. Or look into a very nice, simple Facebook funnel because you can still get attention kind of cheap on that.
Yeah. Nice. And is there a, so those are great ideas in terms of how to start. Is there kind of a path that you wish someone had laid out for you in advance? Like if you of today could go back 7-8 years and give you some advice on that path of lead generation as you grow, what advice would you give someone who's sort of in your shoes 8 years ago?
Ooh, that's a good question. I don't know, like there's a lot of things that I did 8 years ago that the me now would really not enjoy doing. So I'd almost go back and give them a nice pat on the back and say, good, keep at it, you know? I used to when I first started, I cold called from like the yellow pages. I would just type in the names of businesses and this kind of stuff. I'd just pick up the phone and dial all day long. And that's how I got my first few. I'd physically walk around the neighborhood that I lived in at the time, downtown Vancouver, and just knock on the doors of businesses and just have these crappily printed out flyers and like all this stuff that, you know, I would not want to do now because we have leads coming in. But you got to do what you got to do when you first start up. You gotta pound the doors down. You gotta knock on the, you know, you gotta phone call them. All that kind of stuff has to go through for you to build that pipeline. But if I was gonna say one thing, I would say focus in on some stuff that you know you don't got the big budget back in the day. So focus in on organic. Go learn how to actually build a brand organically. Because one thing I did not know how to do is, you know, how do you take advantage of these systems and these places organically? Being back then, Facebook pages weren't dead yet, right? So go knock me in the head and remind me, hey, you've got an asset that's going to die off in about 5 years. You should probably put that to use, right? So that right now would be like Facebook groups. LinkedIn automation is almost on the edge. It's almost too saturated right now. So if you're going to jump in, like those systems are something you should take advantage of until you get the budget and then you can start pumping in the ads.
Yeah, that's great. Great advice. So we've run out of time and I apologize. I'd love to continue the dialogue, but and I really appreciate you taking the time. I know you're busy and really it's gracious for you to spend some time with the audience. Before we go though, last question, and people want to connect with you, find out more about what you're doing. What's a great way for them to do that?
Yeah, I think right now, the biggest thing that I'd like you guys to go check out, if you're an agency owner and you're interested in working with real estate agents at all whatsoever, go to Facebook, go to Real Estate Ads That Work. That's the title of the group okay, we'll let you in right away. We're constantly doing free trainings. We're doing free webinars. There's all kinds of systems and stuff that you can take, leverage, and turn into better results for your clients right inside that group. So Real Estate Ads That Work, the Facebook group. And yeah, I hope to see you in there.
Great. And that link is below the video here for you on the show notes page. If you're out and about listening to the audio, come on back and click through and connect up with Cody. Thanks so much. Gracious offer for inviting folks in. Thanks so much.
Thanks.
And thanks for being with us on this episode of the Six to Seven Figure Show, everyone. I've been your host, Frank Bria. And just a quick reminder about the free high ticket program Core Offer Black Book. Contains more than 60 pages of standard operating procedures on how to run your coaching, consulting, or expert-based service business. You can download that for free at the show's homepage, 6to7.show. That's 6to7.show for your free black book. Cody, thanks so much for being with us on this episode.
No problem. Thanks a lot, guys.
And we'll see you on the next episode of the 6to7 Figure Show. Make it happen. All right. Bye-bye.